I'm Lauren Gies, I'm an extension plant pathologist, University of Nebraska-Lincoln, located on the Lincoln campus. I'm a state soybean pathologist. Bob Wright, extension entomologist, located in the Lincoln campus as well. And Bob is general entomologist, does focus on
field crops.
Field crops in
corn,
general.
Corn, soybeans mostly.
So they mix it up in entomology. We just have one crop in pathology, so it makes our life easy. I don't know why, but anyway, there you go. So we're going to go through seed treatments, and then we're going to talk about as well that R3 application. So looking at fungicides, fungicides, insecticides, at both inputs there. That's kind of the focus of this stop. Bob's going to start out, and then I'm going to come in a little bit later.
Well, when we talk about insecticide use in crops, we want to think about it in the context of integrated pest management. Use of insecticides is one tool among many that we want to be thinking about. And so as you think about your soybean operation, you should be thinking about what your common pest problems are, how frequently you have problems with different pests, and try to make decisions, long-term decisions, whether it's variety selection, planting date, insecticide use, other things, crop rotation, that can try to minimize some of the damage caused by insects. So we don't want to just think about insecticides, but think about biological controls, cultural controls, and think about the idea that we don't have to get rid of all the insects in a field for it to be profitable. A certain level of insects is tolerable, and to a certain extent actually desirable, because it helps keep the natural enemies around to control things if we have an outbreak of something. So key components to make IPM work, you have to be checking your field or scouting to know what problems you have, how they're changing over time, whether they're reaching economic thresholds. Obviously, it's important to identify the pest problems you have, so you're making the right management decisions for the insects that are problems in your area. And then the use of thresholds, and particularly for leaf-feeding insects, we have pretty good thresholds, pretty well-researched that we can rely on. And they're relatively easy to use because all defoliating insects cause similar damage, so we don't have to necessarily have specific thresholds for different insects. So sort of keep this in the back of your mind in the rest of the discussion here. So one of the general themes we're going to talk about, whether it's seed treatments or foliar insecticide use, just ask the question, do insurance applications apply? What we mean by insurance applications is when you treat and you don't really know what pest levels you have or what insects you have. Particularly with foliar insecticides, we often have people, with the last glyphosate application, or Lauren's talking about with the fungicide application, you put in a low rate or some rate of insecticide just to clean up the field, or just in case there might be some insects causing problems. And that isn't something we usually recommend, again, because you're not targeting a particular insect and not following the thresholds. This can also be looked at in terms of the seed treatment insecticides we have. The Cruiser and Poncho are the two major ones that are being used now. They're both the same class of insecticide, neonicotinoids. And this is some research that Tom Hunt, actually not Tom Hunt, Northeast Ag Consulting worked on several years ago with funding from the Soybean Board. They were looking at two treatments, the Cruiser Max Pack seed treated and untreated seed, and this was replicated large strip trials. They counted insects, primarily bean leaf beetles and soybean aphids, and looked at yield. Basically, the short message is over 3 years, they had no significant difference in yield and only a very slight yield advantage in a couple of cases from using the Cruiser. And basically, Cruiser is a very effective insecticide for early season pests, but if you don't have a lot of early season pests, you may not see a yield advantage. And so that's sort of the idea or the take-home message here. If you don't typically have problems with early season insects, it may not pay to use a seed treatment. The one thing with seed treatments, though, that is a good advantage, if we're talking about the soil insects like wireworms or seed corn maggots, there is no rescue treatment for those. So if you have a history of any of those soil insect problems early in the season, seed treatments are a good idea, because you can't wait until you see that you have a problem to treat for those. But a lot of places we don't have high populations of bean leaf beetles, and the seed treatments are not active long enough to really give us control against soybean aphids. They are systemic within the plant, and if you have early season soybean aphid populations, seed treatments can help. But in Nebraska, typically we don't see many soybean aphids until July, and at that time, or even into August, and at that time the seed treatment is not going to help us. So think about why are you using insecticides, what pests you're trying to target. And these are sort of the take-home points from this study. They did find that the Cruiser Max significantly reduced the densities of the adult bean leaf beetles that colonized the plant in the spring. And at times, later generations of bean leaf beetles were also reduced from the seed treatment treatments. There was also significantly reduced injury from bean leaf beetles, but it was relatively low and not at economic levels. So it was impacting bean leaf beetles, but in these fields, we did not have high populations of bean leaf beetles. It did not significantly reduce soybean aphid. And with the planting dates they were doing at this time, which was early to mid-May planting dates, they didn't see any significant yield impacts from the treatment. Again, they had relatively low levels of insects, and we wouldn't expect control of low levels of insects to increase yield. Controlling bean leaf beetles may be important if you have a history of bean pod mottle virus, which is vectored by bean leaf beetles, but this was not a significant issue at that time. And again, the planting time seed treatments are not recommended for soybean aphids in Nebraska, because typically the aphids show up later in the season at the time that the systemic insecticide is not having a lot of activity. So that's one example of something with an insurance application. And this time, in this case, seed treatments. We're also going to want to talk about use of foliar insecticides in a similar way. But again, be aware that one benefit of the seed treatments is some of the soil insects, we don't have a post-emergence application we can use to control them. So if you have a history of problems with some of those early season soil insects, the seed treatments are a good practice, because you don't have an alternative to control them. But don't expect them to help with soybean aphid in Nebraska. Now moving on to above ground insects, particularly defoliating insects, but also soybean aphid. There's been a lot of work on a lot of different crops. And this just shows on the left column is yield, and on the right is going to the right is increasing injury. And basically it shows that on the left here, you can have a low level of injury and no impact on yield. There's a certain level of tolerance of the plant. And some of this can be things like we have Japanese beetles here feeding on the upper canopy leaves. A certain level of, especially feeding on the upper canopy, isn't going to cause yield loss, because all that does is lets more light go down into the canopy and be intercepted by leaves that were previously shaded. But even without that, there's a certain level of injury that doesn't cause any yield loss. In some crops, we've actually seen a low level of injury can increase yield. It stimulates growth of new tissue, and it results in yield increases. But as we increase injury from left to right, we get to some point where we start seeing declining yield. And in the middle, there's usually a linear relationship between injury and yield. And then if you get down to severe injury, you've already lost most of the crop at that point, and it doesn't have a linear relationship. But the main point is that we can live with low levels of insects because they don't cause either any yield loss or a level of yield loss that wouldn't be paid for by the treatment. And if we're not having yield loss, why do we want to be using insecticides? The other thing to think about with using our common insecticides, are pyrethroids, organophosphates, other products, is they're broad spectrum, they're not selective. And particularly in soybeans, there are a lot of natural enemies that can help us control pest insects like soybean aphids and caterpillars and other things. And all of these are damaged when we use, at least the top two are damaged when we use insecticides. And if we use them needlessly early in the season, we knock these down. Surviving insects or insects that come in later have less predators or parasites to feed on them. And oftentimes they can survive better because we've helped them by killing off the natural enemies. So be aware that every time you use an insecticide, you're knocking down the natural enemies and make it easier for the pest insects to survive. And actually, there's data from some other crops, not so much soybeans, that some fungicides that we use for disease control in crops can inhibit. There are also pathogens that attack insects. There are some fungi that can attack insects if the weather conditions are right. And if we use foliar fungicides, there's some research that suggests that we can suppress some of the beneficial fungi that can help control insects. So we don't want to, and a lot of these are relatively small insects. You may not see them if you're not really looking, but they are helping us control the pest insects in the field. Now when we talk about insecticide use in crops, there's a couple of terms that we use. And we're going to talk about these in a second, but they're similar concepts, but they relate to what happens after you use an insecticide. Resurgence is, again, when you've killed off all the natural enemies, but you haven't killed off all the pest insects. Those survivors are better able to survive and reproduce after the spray than before. And so you get a resurgence or an upsurge in the population. Similar concept is flare-up. I guess resurgence is when there was an economic population that you treated, but again, you killed off the natural enemies and you never get 100% of the insects, and so those survivors are able to reproduce and resurge or go back up. Flare-ups is when you treat and there's a low level of some insect that wasn't maybe the primary target, like if you had spider mites in the field or soybean aphids in the field, and you were treating for something else, the same thing. You've killed off the natural enemies and they're able to reproduce and survive better after the spray, and they may build up to economic populations even if they weren't before. The other thing we have to be aware of is that a lot of these insects will fly around, and you can have a recolonization of a field from new insects that weren't there before after you treat, and again, the same concept. They come into a field that's a desert, biological desert, in terms of natural enemies, and they're a lot more likely to able to survive and establish and grow in that field. And if you're talking about multiple insecticide applications, you can have multiple cases of recolonization over time. And this is some data that Dr. Tom Hunt at Concord did several years ago. This is with soybean aphid. And what he had was some field cages that he covered, small plot areas. Some was with a very fine mesh that kept all insects out, Another one was with a more open mesh that kept out large insects like lady beetles, but let in small insects like these pirate bugs, which are important predators of soybean aphids. And the so the control is an open plot without any field cage on it. The partial exclusion is something that excluded lady beetles but let smaller insects in, like the aureus or minute pirate bug. And then the orange, which is the one where we have the high populations, was a very fine mesh that excluded all insect predators and parasites. And they artificially infested these cages with a certain number of soybean aphids. And you can see within 40 days, 30 or 40 days after treatment, well, by 30 days it was above threshold, and it got up to over 2,500 aphids per plant in the absence of any natural enemies with those weather conditions. But if we had some access for natural enemies, either partial or no exclusion, these natural enemies were able to keep them at very low levels. So we do have a lot of effective predators and parasites of soybean aphids. If we don't kill them off by using insecticides needlessly, they can help control soybean aphids. And so this is a very powerful demonstration of the value of these tiny insects that you may not even be aware are out there. And particularly these minute pirate bugs, about an eighth of an inch long. They also feed on spider mites, as well as caterpillar eggs and other small insects, small bugs. You may have found this on you late in the fall at corn harvest. A lot of times they're flying around and will land on people and test bite people, and you can feel them when they bite you. But they normally feed on insects. And also, one thing about some of these predatory bugs, they also will feed on plant sap. And that's one other issue with the systemic seed treatments, is that particularly predatory bugs will feed on plants to get some moisture and also some nutrition. And having the seed treatments can suppress some of these insects early season, because they are feeding on the plant to some extent or extracting some sap. So that's another issue. So what we want to avoid is a situation like this, and we can talk about soybean aphid populations, and that's what this is related to. If we treat early in the season, like in this case, mid-July or early July, there's enough growing season time that the populations, there are always going to be some survivors in the field. Those populations that after that first treatment, they're able to survive better because we've killed off the natural enemies. They grow and reach a threshold, and you have to treat again. Again, you've knocked off the natural enemies, and then if it's good growing conditions, they can grow again, and you have to treat a third time maybe if you start early. And what this doesn't show is the scenario: if you wait until we reach the threshold, you may only have to treat once, or maybe not at all. And this is a real problem in some of the areas in the south where they have longer growing seasons and higher pest pressures, where you get into what we call sort of the insecticide pesticide treadmill, where you start using insecticides, and that's the only thing that is left to control the insects, because you've killed off the natural enemies and you have to treat multiple times. We want to avoid this, where we have multiple populations that build up to economic levels that we have to treat. So sort of the take-home message that I want to leave you with is: think about the pest problems in your area. What are the common pests that you deal with? Think about practices that will inhibit their growth or suppress their growth in terms of crop rotations, maybe variety selection, planting date, other issues like that. Monitor the populations in the field during the summer where we have thresholds. Follow those thresholds and try to treat only when needed. and you can take advantage of the natural biological control that's out there that you don't have to pay for. But if you use insecticides at a time when we don't have economic problems, you may cause worse problems later in the growing season. Any questions about soybean insects?
Yeah. What are the sightings for aphids this year?
It's been pretty low. Obviously this is probably too cold for soybean aphids, but they do better in 70s and 80s. When we get above 95 or so, they really start dropping off. But there's still time for them to develop in some areas, but Tom Hunt is our main soybean aphid entomologist up at Concord, and he hasn't heard of anybody having treatable levels in Nebraska. I know we're getting some reports from northern Iowa and parts of Minnesota that they're seeing economic levels in that area, but we haven't found any yet in Nebraska. But keep on scouting. If we get, I know we're getting some warm weather next week. They can grow relatively quickly if the weather's right. Yes?
There's been some concern about soybean insecticide seed treatments affecting the honeybees. What's their future if they do affect that?
The question is about the systemic seed treatments affecting honeybees. That is a concern, honeybees will forage in soybeans to some extent and collect nectar. We have a lot of research in Nebraska right now looking at pesticide effects on honeybees, and a lot of other people looking at that too. And regular EPA is looking at that as well. So there might be some changes, but that is the one concern.
Actually, and Bob, too, just to add on to that, there is just, because I'm working with a student too, there's a student in entomology working on looking for some of those insecticides in soybean flowers and okay. What levels they're at. So
yeah.
some good research going on to really start to investigate it a little bit more.
Yeah.
Good.
Thank you.
Bob, I'm going to ask you a question too. One of the things whenever I share the information with them, we talk about people using fungicides and insecticides at R3. A lot of times that combination. What is the real risk? You know, everybody talks about flare-up and these types of things. I mean, how often have you seen it, and what is the real risk there? Because that's something that everybody worries about.
We've seen it occasionally, and we don't have a lot of soybean aphids around this year, so we may not see the problem. We've also seen it with spider mites in soybeans where people used, probably it was more an insecticide with a glyphosate application in June, maybe.
Okay.
And then later in August, they had problems with spider mites or soybean aphids. The other issue I didn't mention that we should bring up is a concern about insecticide resistance. Most of our insecticides now in soybeans, a lot of them are pyrethroids. We're using a lot of pyrethroids on a lot of crops. In the South, where they used them a lot more, they have had problems with insecticide resistance developing to pyrethroids. So that's something to be concerned about. We don't want to needlessly develop insecticide resistance as another issue.
I think we need some pyrethroid-resistant predators you guys need to develop.
They've done work on that in perennial systems like tree fruit crops to breed predatory mites that are resistant to the commonly used insecticides. And the one problem with obviously annual crops is everything gets reset each year, so it's not as persistent as perennial crops like tree fruit crops where they would stay around once you establish them. Yes?
What's the latest growth stage that people are going to spray for the physical threshold there?
Well, basically, currently the 250 aphid per plant threshold is up through R6. There hasn't been as much research on later stages. We know the threshold is higher on later stages, probably significantly higher. Don't know exactly when you can totally cut it off. But that's something to think about. If we have aphid populations develop this year, they're probably going to peak late just because of the weather conditions. Okay, I'll be around all day if there's any other questions.
All right, now we're going to go into I think this is the more fun part of the presentation, but hey, just a little biased. Also, I appreciate different people bring me bouquets. How about this? Somebody brought in this one, and we got Cercospora blight. I found this one on my own. We got Phytophthora. We've seen quite a bit of that. We'll talk about that more in a little bit. A little bit of SDS. and some other stuff we got out here, but it's always fun to see a little bit. Although overall, I would say it's a little boring being a plant pathologist this year in general. There's not a tremendous amount of disease out there. It's changing a little bit. We're going to talk about those seed treatments first. And so one of the things we're going to do is look at your grower's handbook. And on page 2 is where we're going to start. Now, on page 2 on that table, that's where we've got the seed treatment trial results from the last 2 years at the Soybean Management Field Day sites with that. And so I'm going to start out by asking you this. We're going to interact a little bit. How many of you use seed treatments right now? Keep your hands up. Same hands. How many of you put an insecticide in there with it? Okay. Now, of you that had use of seed treatment, how many of you have had stand problems? Put your hands back up if you used a seed treatment. How many of you had stand problems in those fields you use them in? That's what we see a lot. Few hands usually. Okay. So why are you using them? If you haven't had stand problems, why are you doing it?
Insurance.
Insurance. Okay. They're worth more right now. It's easy to buy insurance, right? Okay. My question for you is, how much insurance do you need? Do you buy hurricane insurance on your house in Nebraska? No. Okay. So the question is, do you need the fungicide, any insecticide? Why are you doing it? So that's what I want you to think about a little bit. Okay. So we're going to show you what we've done out here to evaluate that insurance as far as no treatment, only fungicides, and then just adding an insecticide. Okay. Because one of the things that I would say is that a lot of times the insurance you're looking for is to get the seed out of the ground when you're planting. If you're going to early planting cool soils, probably the fungicide is most important. Okay. Now, Bob may disagree with that. Depends on the situation. Okay. With that. And timing is everything, right? But let's look at the data on table 1. Okay. 2011, 2012. Over the last couple years, one of the things we've done is kind of done this battery of all the seed, main seed treatments out there. Same thing on the foliar side we're going to talk about. Okay, now let's just see how it worked. These are averages for 4 locations. Okay, now you see your check up there, no treatment is 62.8. And then go to the bottom. Let's talk about LSD a little bit. Okay, now let's talk about LSD. What's LSD? Somebody said, that's a drug from the 70s. Wow, hey man, maybe I still got it. Where are we at? No, okay. Least significant difference, right? Okay, now, I'm a little bit different on this. Most of the time, and how many times have you seen somebody show you a data table? A lot of times a university researcher, right? Says, hey, look at this. We got all this range and means. There's no difference. And you look at the table and you go, wait a minute. There's 5 bushel between treatment 1 and treatment 3. What the heck are you talking about? Right? Have you ever seen that? Okay, you see it, right? Well, variation, that's where least significant difference comes in. Okay, most people use alpha 0.05. So they could say 95% confidence that there's no they'd have to have 90% confidence to say there's difference between treatment 1 and treatment 3. Okay? I'm a little bit different on that. I think you guys are investors and you're trying to make decisions, so I think you need to know what the chance is in the trial. It doesn't do me any good to show you that and say there's no difference. Okay? I'm different in a lot of ways. I'm one of the only Republicans at the University of Nebraska.
Yeah.
You try that. Try that for 15 years and see how that works out for you, man. Trying to change them from within. About to give up. But anyway, we'll keep going. So I take and I say 90%. Okay? Let's use 90% confidence, 0.1. I even go beyond that. I say let's use 75%. So there's a 75% chance if you got 1.8 bushel between 62.8, so 64.6 or greater, that if that's different, there's a 75% chance it's real. Okay? That's what I look at. Okay? So that's why I show you those different numbers. So in 2011, 64.6, there's several of them that hit over that. Okay? 2011 was the year we had a lot of rains after planting. Pretty good test for seed treatments. These weren't sites that necessarily had history of stand problem that you raise your hand and say it was different. Okay? But several points there it did work. Now 2012, we did the same thing. We got a few differences in there on what we had for treatments, where the lines are at. So for example, you know, the Bayer treatments, for example, had Trilex in 2012. They went to the Evergold Energy, their new product line. Okay. 2012, first thing you see is those LSDs went up pretty much. They doubled, right? I can tell you all across the United States in plot data, that's what happened and why. Yeah, just crazy environmental conditions. Drought, soils don't dry the same. Uniformity, heat, these types of things, and that made your variability just really huge. And so in that, but even if you look at the averages, and even if you went down, there's not, the averages, no effect. Okay? Not as much pressure for seed treatment. If we would have had something that made seed germinate and grow out of the ground in drought, that would have been the best thing, right? But anyway, but no effect. So again, you know, I always feel that our job is to show you what we have for results. You got to make the decision on whether or not you use it. So when we look at seed treatments from the disease standpoint, what are we looking at controlling? You know, this year, for example, we had a lot of rain right after planting. So we were looking primarily at Pythium. We saw quite a bit of Pythium this year. Cool, wet conditions. Cooler soils don't really favor as much Phytophthora, so we definitely saw more Pythium. Now, later in the year, warming up now, and in many of you are in areas maybe where you had a heavy rain event, and then a couple weeks after that, we're picking up Phytophthora. Okay, I've got that one. We're going to talk a little bit more about that, but we're seeing that right now in some areas. And just those areas where they had pockets where they got a 2-inch dump, and then a little bit later we'll see it. Rhizoctonia, if you're from an area where you have more sandy soils, we tend to see that in sandier fields a lot of times. And really, primarily, if you look at this treatment list, they're going to be effective against most of these, okay? And just about everything. But there's going to be some a little bit better in different situations. Rhizox one, you know, just for example, we've got Syngenta's Sedaxane or Vibrant's really good Rhizoctonia product, just for an example. Strobilurins tend to do better on Rhizoctonias, so make sure you got that. And then let's talk for a minute on Phytophthora, since we are seeing that a little bit right now. And again, when we say we're seeing it, I mean, does everybody here have a Phytophthora problem? No, but some of you may, so we're gonna touch base on it. Or if you scout or anything, here's an example of Phytophthora where you see that dark stem lesion, plants wilt and die. Real easy to identify, any of you here, if you see this, you know it's Phytophthora, okay? Now, the key with this is, you may say, well, I'm using a Phytophthora-resistant variety, and I'm still seeing dead plants occasionally. Okay, with Phytophthora, they rank in the seed books tolerance, and then they rate specific gene resistance when you're selecting a variety in those fields. A lot of research has shown high tolerance, making sure you're selecting a variety with good tolerance, and then if you're seeing those occasional plants scattered out in the field, I'd change that gene. Let that field be your bioassay to say, hey, that Phytophthora that's in the field, there's a lot of diversity in it, now it's to the point where it's affecting this other gene. So maybe you need to move from 1K to 3A or whatever, okay? But the biggest thing is high tolerance. Make sure you have that. Then the other one is that seed treatment. I mentioned most of them are effective against all of them, but we talk about increasing the methanoxam or metalaxyl rate. So for example, straight apron max is not gonna be enough for Phytophthora. You gotta add to it, okay? If we've got other things, a lot of the different, you know, one thing I do not keep up on anymore are all the different seed companies and their combinations and their patented little proprietary thing, right? That they do a blend, and company A's got this seed treatment. Ask your seedsman if it's got enough for Phytophthora if you're dealing with that. So when to use it? Maybe this is where everybody that raised their hand and said they were using seed treatments early on, maybe this is the list you think about. If you got a history, for sure. How about somebody, maybe, I bet some of you dropped your population significantly and you said, now I need insurance even more. So then you treat it. Going into an unknown, I would do that too, okay? But again, if you don't have a history of the stand problem or you're not going in early in cooler soils, everybody always says, what's early? Well, what's early? How do you answer that? 60 is temperature based, guys. 60 degrees is optimum for soybean germination. Cooler you are, the more time it takes the seed to get out. If you're at 50 degrees, 55, 60 is off. If you're at 50, you're in cool soils, and it's going to take a while for that seed to get out. Okay? So just base it on your soil temperature and when you plant. That was totally different. I mean, there's about a month difference in that in the last 2 years in extremes, right? Okay. And then again, Phytophthora history, that's when you sure want to use a seed treatment, again, in combination with genetics. And then insect pressure, and Bob touched on that quite a bit. But really, you know, as far as seed treatment, insecticides on soybean, I mean, Bob, would you agree? Bean leaf beetle, probably as far as a predictor, if we're looking at those above feeding things from the standpoint of fall populations going in, or what would you say about that?
No, there's some research in that at Iowa State, but we haven't validated that in Nebraska. And plus, the beetles will fly around. They'll search out the early emerging fields, so if you've had problems in the area in the past, and again, early planted beans would be most at risk from mealy beetles.
So questions on seed treatments?
Do seedling diseases, do they vary with soil temperature? Are they as active in cold as they are warm?
They do vary, and for example, when we're in cooler soils, we tend to see more pythium, okay? Fusarium, as we start to warm up, Rhizoctonia likes a little warmer temperature, Phytophthora likes a little warmer temperature. So the other one is, that's where that history comes in, because you'll have fields that are really hot for seedling disease, and you know if you plant that field and you get a heavy rain event, you have a problem, okay? Or you got a sandy field that you know that, and I deal with Rhizoctonia there all the time. The ones that I've seen that have been the most severe, though, if you have a field that I just get really hit anytime I get a rain, that's Phytophthora. That's been the one that I see that like really takes a lot of stand a lot of times, if it's a high percentage, okay, that type of scenario. And then you see Rhizoc with stress. Field gets hail, get more Rhizoc. Sometimes you see it after certain herbicides, these types of things. Any questions on seed treatments? All right, we're going to jump. And I'm going to be here for a little while, too. I apologize today. I do have to leave at 11:30. I got a special event today. I have my first PhD student graduating this afternoon. I'm going to get to do a hooding, so I'm pretty excited about that. So, anyway, soybean foliar use in R3 is now where we were going to go. Okay. So in R3, you make an application. How many of you use foliar fungicides? Somebody's lying. The numbers are bigger than that, guys. I'm sorry. I know the numbers. It's more than that. Okay. If you did it, how many of you put a insecticide with it? Same hands. Okay. All right. Why do you do that?
The co-op told us to.
I had a guy one of the days. He had somebody sitting to me. He said, "Cause he's next to him." He said, "Cause he tells me to do it." I said, "How much do you get an acre to tell him to do that?" So, hey, bottom line, some of you are seeing it returns, right? You feel it pays. That's why we do anything you do, right? Again, you're an investor. When you look at it, 2011, 2012, let's go to page 3. Same scenario, we put out a battery of fungicides with the combination, that insecticide partner from that company over the last 2 years, okay? If you look at 2011 data, the same on those significant levels, 0.1, 0.25, that type of thing. Here's what I saw in 2011, and this matched a lot of other states have seen this over the years. I can tell you the highest hits I've had when I look at yields in all my trials, fungicide, insecticide combinations usually, okay? Average in 2011 was a little over 2 bushel, average with insecticide a little over 4, okay, across the locations. Real consistent if you look at that. Fungicide, insecticide. Just step up. Pretty consistent, okay? The average, if you look across trials in Nebraska for sure, some from co-ops, you know, where you're not in a heavy disease environment, okay? If you get further east, you get south and you look at trials, it's totally different, guys. Okay? Now the companies, they take a lot of that and put it together a lot of times. Some of them just use Nebraska data maybe. But sometimes you're dealing in high disease environments and they throw you an average and it's not the range I'm going to tell you. The range I see is about 1.6 to 2.4, somewhere in there, okay? If I have over 10%, we don't, in Nebraska typically, I mean, you don't have a lot of foliar disease, okay? In most cases. I mean, here's the canopy out here, you know, that we're looking at. I mean, man, he's just getting tore up by foliar disease, isn't he? I mean, I'm telling you, it sucks to be a plant pathologist if this is all you got to work with. Okay? You question the investment in somebody like me, right? Anyway, might do that anyway. But hey, looking at this, you know, that's the kind of canopy a lot of times you're treating, right? Okay? So there's not a lot. But if I have 10% brown spot at the canopy level, 10% of the canopy or more, when I look at trials, I pick up 0.6 bushel more, okay? On average, I mean, about 50 comparisons. So, bottom line, if you have a field that's yellowing, you know you've got a little better chance, right? Okay? And brown spot, again, that's the main one. Not a lot of attention's paid to brown spot, though, really. When you look at it, in a compendium, say maybe 10% yield loss, and doing this about 12 years of spraying, I've seen it one time. I took 10%, I covered it with a fungicide, I got it back. Okay? Maybe it's 5, it's less, okay? Current pricing, 5% is a big number, right? Okay? So that's where you start getting these pickups and these little additions. And definitely there can be plant health effects, okay? I've had no disease, no insect pressure at 10 bushel. I've had no disease, no insect pressure at zero. I've had disease, insect pressure at zero. Doesn't always match, right? Okay? But you know if you have more pressure, you got a better chance. So, let's look at brown spot. And then the other one, that's the main one we're talking about. And then now, you know, throughout most of the areas we've been in, you see a little bit of bacterial blight this year. It's cooler. Blight likes cooler temperatures. Okay? Heavy rain events, stormy conditions, those kinds of things favor it, right? Had a conversation with a grower earlier this week. He said, I'm trying to keep my field clean. I got a lot of that stuff, and nothing, it seems to still be there. You're not going to have any effect to the fungicide, okay? When you're looking at using fungicides, you're not going to have any effect on bacterial blight. That would be the equivalent of trying to spray a fungicide for Goss's blight, okay, in corn. It's not going to happen. Bacterial pustule, it's too cool this year for that one. That's a warm temperature. But again, I don't see a lot of, you're not dealing with loss in that too much. There are some varieties that are more sensitive or susceptible to bacterial blight. And on occasion, you will see early on, occasionally you will see a field that gets hit pretty hard, but it's not very common at all. And if you ever have a problem with that, I would just say, don't check with your seedsman, but they'll know that one's a dog usually. There's just a few of them out there. Another one we're seeing and we will see is downy mildew. Okay, that likes these wet conditions and dew periods. It's a fungus, but this is one we always get calls on because they sprayed the field with a fungicide and they still have it. There's no activity on downy mildew of the products you're going to use, okay? So you're still going to see that one. Powdery mildew, if we'd stay overcast like we are this week, we're going to see more powdery mildew. Your fungicide would affect that. But then the other one that primarily we look at when we're looking at foliar fungicides on beans is frog eye leaf spot. Okay, that is one that if you were in that R3 zone, and we're talking about applications at R3 to early R4, okay, you got a couple weeks there in the window. That's the timing. That would be one if you had any frog eye and you knew the variety was susceptible, I'd say spray. Because you're going to lose with that. Yeah.
You're saying that some of these diseases are more prominent during wet conditions, so good irrigation, is that promoting that?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. So, and particularly, a lot of times, the other part of that, it depends on where you're at in the state, but irrigation, definitely, you know, you're raising the humidity and everything. Your ambient drier air in general in Nebraska and western movement of air currents with dry air helps that a lot. So I think that's why we don't see typically as much disease in our beans as we do when you go east, okay, that way. And that's actually a good point to bring in because one of the things that I'll tell you is that I do not worry too much about resistance development to fungicides in our soybeans in Nebraska. Okay. And there's a couple reasons for that. Let's take a look at some frog eye information. And actually, it's interesting. I've got an Illinois person in the crowd this morning. I'm going to talk about some Illinois-funded research this morning. If we turn to page 4, you're going to see some information from Dr. Carl Bradley at the University of Illinois. Okay, Carl's a colleague and has done a lot of work tracking frog eye resistance. Okay, he was the one that identified it in 2010 with another colleague at the University of Tennessee, okay, where they had strobilurin-resistant frog eye. Now, some of you may say, well, why are you talking to us about this? We're not struggling with frog eye yet. I think it's a nice example, okay, and I think the best thing we can do is show you what can happen and then you decide what you're going to do. Okay. So if you look at page 4, okay, table 3, we're looking at a frog eye leaf spot trial in an area that had strobilurin-resistant frog eye. Okay. And when they've been tracking that now, they're seeing it move up through the Mississippi Delta Valley area. Closest to us, you know, would be that southeastern Missouri area, okay, where they have resistant frog eye. So not something you have to worry about today too much. But it's an area where they have a lot of disease pressure. And it's totally different than your environment here. Okay? When you look at, you know, the guidelines that Carl talks about for resistance management, his recommendations, okay, are, you know, up here. And I've got resistant varieties, cultural practices, reduced disease levels. Okay, you guys are rotating. How much are you, as far as for getting resistance to develop, you have to expose a large number of that pathogen to that fungicide to select for. Okay, if we want to develop a resistant organism to do some sort of tracking project in the lab, all we'll do is put a whole bunch of it out on a plate and spray it with whatever tracker we want, and eventually we'll get one. Okay? Just a matter of time. Do enough, you'll get it. You guys spray a fungicide out, you know, you're screening that population for resistance, right? But how much are you really exposing? You know, here we're a couple weeks past application time, and again, this is pretty common. You're not exposing as much, okay? That's one of the reasons why I say your resistance risk cup is lower, okay? The only thing that's happening in Nebraska, I would say, that favors a little bit is no-till, okay? But that's not, don't change, but that's something that wouldn't be a cultural practice that you recommend to reduce it, but it's not enough to change. Your disease levels are still low, okay? Now, another one up there, fungicides with modes, different modes of action. Let's look at the table. This is where this comes in. Now on that table, first thing I want to point out, frog eye leaf spot severity, in his non-treated check, he's got 56%. Now what's that rating? That's 56% of the top third of that canopy. Okay? So when you take the top part of that canopy out, that's where you get that real yield hit, right? Because that's all your photosynthetic area that's really capturing a lot. So that's why a lot of times in frog eye trials, you see real relationships, if it's severe, to yield changes. So he's got his yield. Now, the frack group, what's a frack group? Anybody can answer that, I'll go over to the tent and get you a donut. You cannot answer. Fungicide Resistance Action Committee, okay? Now what is that? That's a primary industry organization that tracks resistance globally around the world, okay? They have a vested interest, right? They've got products they want to market. They want to make sure they're effective. They also keep the registry and do the coding for new modes of action. There's over 40 modes of action of fungicides. You only see a half a dozen of them on the market now. Okay, a lot of them, it's just not effective, they don't work, pathogenicity, specificity, all kinds of things. Okay, but you just see a half a dozen of them. But the key is there, 11 is a strobilurin. Okay, so when you go down a column and you look at 11, first one you run into there on that table is headline. Okay, if you look at the severity, it's the same. Okay, even though you treat it, this is about a month after application, so the disease has progressed after that treatment. You go down there, and then let's look at one with a multiple mode of action. I'm just picking on a couple here. So we got Preaxor right below that. You drop significantly. You change, you got two modes of action. You go down a little further, he's got a veto in there. That's a straight strobilurin, no activity. And then again, a lot of those with multiple modes of action, you're getting pretty good control. Or you're increasing your growth significantly. One thing I want to point out too, somebody brought this one up, Echo's in there. It's the lowest severity in his trial. Okay, what's Echo? It's chlorothalonil. Okay, it's a chloronitrile, cheap. It's only going to be active for 7 to 10 days. I'm not telling you to use it. Okay, but in this situation, he hit it just right. And if you look below it, he's got Thompson and Folicure. Now those are systemic products because if you go right, you know he picked up 9 more bushel. His yield difference. Okay, so that's an example of something where you've got a product that's not systemic. And you just hit a certain disease. He's not showing you there's other diseases as well. And then that systemic product, you're picking up a lot more, right? So that's your difference there when you're looking at that change. But again, you know, you see the differences with the different modes of action. And if you think about, you know, his idea to use multiple modes of action, think about the products that you're using, okay? And where that industry is going. All of them have multiple modes of action. Stratego YLD, multiple modes of action. Okay. Quilt, Quadristop, multiple modes of action. Straight headlines still out there, but you're going to see that pushed to pre-axial, okay? Multiple modes of action. Okay. So again, you're doing resistance management, and also even better than that, and the companies didn't organize this, but if you look at it, you know, you've got with that those three main products, with Stratego YLD, if you looked at that, pre-axial and Quilt, just for example, you've got different modes of action within those two. So that helps too, overall, okay? Because I would tell you, when you look at resistance management, if somebody here says, I'm going to be the best environmental steward in the world, I'm not going to use fungicides unless I have to use them for disease control, like Carl recommends, and your neighbor uses them, and it was returning, you're going to have this problem immediately. These are airborne things, okay? So that's where this overall scope of multiple modes of action differences, that's a great thing, okay? So again, those are the reasons that I say in general, I'm not too worried about resistance management, or resistance in our diseases, that way in soybean. Okay? Questions on that?
What's the status of SDS?
In Nebraska, status of SDS very, very low. Okay, have not had a lot of reports. I've got one here that was brought in today, a small, you know, a pocket in the field. In general, most of our fields in Nebraska, not huge areas, still little pockets, smaller areas. We are seeing it spread. There's definitely in this area, there's some that, you know, we've had fields at half, but not a big, near as big as like Illinois and as you go east Iowa, these types of things. Now is the time you'll see that. All the stem and root rots, SDS, Phytophthora, brown stem rot. We're really seeing more brown stem rot this year. Your dry conditions at harvest last year really reduce your potential for SDS because it's favored by compaction. Your worst scenario for SDS is wet harvest the year before, coming in, conditions are right to plant early, get some rain after that, and you go forward.
What can you do to prevent it?
Prevent it, the best thing is really variety selection. Seed treatments have really, there's no data to show that it's been effective. And then anything you can do to help with compaction. You know, there's evidence of, you know, nobody's gonna plow, right? But I mean, those kinds of, you know, rippers and things like that, they do help if you've got compaction issues. All right, let's stand up. We're going to go out here and we're going to take a look at what we did in this crazy experiment. But these are the treatments we've got in there. We've got on the seed treatment, on the seed input, we got non-treated. I don't want you to get too confused here. When we look at these, we use Syngenta treatments on this. We've got just the fungicide, and then we've got with the insecticide. So this is Cruiser Max Plus, and what we did is we did a little special blend here. We added more aprons so it's all equal. And then we put Vibrance in there also, okay? So this is just the equivalent fungicide, but just adding the insecticide. Okay, so really getting at that question. Then on the R3 application timing, we were doing the same thing. We use Bayer treatments here. So we've got no treatment, we've got Stratego YLD, and then we've got Stratego YLD with leverage. Okay, so again, we're just looking at fungicide and insecticide, yes, no. Okay, somebody might say, well, why didn't you use the insecticide that, alone? That's not the thing you guys are thinking about, I don't think. I think these are the decisions you're gonna make. Really. And then also, when you get to Charlie Shapiro's stop, you're going to hear about fertility. We had 17 pounds of N on at start, and then we put 25 pounds of N in at R3, and that was on and off too. Okay? So now, how we get to 240 plots is, this is on this, it's on this, and it's on that. This is on this, it's on this, it's on this, and this is here, and here, and here. And then it's also with and without 17 at start, with and without 25, with both fertilities and this. And then it's also at 15 inches and it's at 30 inches. Is that crazy? Who wants to come and help us? Okay. But the reality is because of that design, think about this. When you look at these tables, I've got four reps of this, and I've got four reps of this. They're all replicated four times, and then I got four reps of this. But in this design, I've got this on this, and this, and this, and fertility. So I can tell you at the end, or we hope, that this is better, or if there's an interaction, if all the layers pay better, we got some power to say we got more replication here. So instead of four plots, we got 12 or more of each. Okay. So that's the goal here. And if you see some pain out there at different places when they went through and sprayed, I don't know if Keith introduced Steve Spitka, but he's the person that was running around and working on all these. When they sprayed, they color-coded everything, and I had guys come out and color-code and spray, so, you know, all the ones that got this had a color, or that one had a color at R3. He missed one plot he messed up out of four locations. I said, the guy's doing a great job. So. Really good. So anyway, and we sprayed them with a large sprayer, so we're trafficking the outside, and then we're going to harvest the center two rows on the 30s and the center three on the 15s. Okay, and then you guys will get the data out of that. We're also doing assessments for foliar diseases and insect injury throughout the season, and we're doing stand counts. We did a stand count early, we'll do a harvest stand count, and all that stuff will be available for you to decide. And hopefully, in the end, we can say this one was better than this one and that.